However, that's not true. That's not true. Now, if anyone in here has never said something about someone that that someone doesn't know that they said, would you please just go get in your car and you can go home. You're done for the day. Okay. Nobody's leaving? Okay, then we're in the right place, aren't we? You see, I gave you these papers and they're on the table. And it says, write five people you like and five people you don't like. And I gave you the opportunity to take them home last week. You don't have to do that now, but we're going to talk about that. The Lord woke me up August 16th, I wrote it down, with write 10 people you don't like and 10 people you do. And then the next thing that was spoken to me is, where is God on your list? I want you to just reflect silently, please. Because God is not on everyone's list in the same place. Sometimes God's on the top of our like list, and sometimes he's on the top of our don't like list. Many of us have gotten mad at the Lord or questioned the Lord or wondered why, Lord, and we put him in these lists. But God doesn't belong on the list. God is above this list. God is not even partly able to be on our list. Because God is God, and he should be honored, glorified, praised, and just submitted to completely. Amen. If we put God in categories that we put people in, we're going to get confused, and confusion is of the devil. So first of all, you can make a note, God doesn't belong on that list. And he certainly doesn't belong to be jumping from on the list that we like and on the list that we don't like. So I want you to just think of maybe one or two people, because we're not going to sit and work on this. But think of two people that you really, really like. You really like them. You look up to them. Occasionally, we've even put politicians on that list. But they don't belong on that list either. Because unless you really know them personally, a personal relationship is where we want to go with this. The people that we don't like, why don't you like them? Is it because that they have done things that have maybe hurt your feelings? Maybe they don't think like you do. Maybe they don't believe like you do. So we put them on the don't like list. And maybe that's our key, that we don't have to be part of their life. That's not what God teaches, but that's what we do. Then I want you to look, where does yourself play a part in those lists? Are the people on your like list because they really do things for you and they treat you nice, and the people on your don't like list are because they don't do what you think is right and blah, blah, blah. So this is a really good exercise to go home and do. And when you do this, you're going to see that the reason you even have the list comes down to revolving around you. The people on your don't like list are on some people's like list. The people on your like list are on some people's don't like list. But nowhere in the Bible does God teach us that we have the right to put people on either list. Am I right? We do that because we judge. We do that because of ourselves. And then I want you to look at those lists. If you turn your paper over, and I want you to realize that God loves all the people on both of your list. So wouldn't it be great to take your do not like list and go to the Lord in your prayer closet and ask him to show you how he sees them? Because last week I told you the explanation of walking that road to Calvary. When Jesus walked that road to Calvary, he didn't stop and say, "Hold it. Stop cursing me, stop spitting on me, stop hitting me. I'm not doing this for Stan. I don't even like Stan, and Stan's never going to accept me, so we won't do this for Stan. Hold it. I'm only doing this for the people that like me. I'm only going to go to that cross for those that will never turn their back on me, because we all sin. I can't say that you would never sin." You see, God doesn't revolve his love and himself on what we do. We do that. And that's where the devil gets in there and has a field day with you, because the devil tells you how bad you are. And then what's even worse, you believe him. You need to begin to not only see others through the eyes of Jesus, but to begin to see yourself through his eyes. Because what he sees is beautiful. Everything is beautiful to him. He created it. He created every single person. He created everything. He created the whole plan. And when we have to begin today to revolve around him, he's not on our list. It's not, God is not dependent on how you feel about him. Well, if he doesn't do what I ask him, then I'm just going to turn my back on him. Do you really think that's going to affect him? It affects you. The joy of the Lord is our strength. When we turn our back on our God, we are the ones that are going to suffer. Not him. He already did what he needed to do. So again, I'll repeat, our self must die. When we die to ourselves, it's easier to love. It will fill up your I love these people list, and the people on the I don't like are going to slowly be erased and put that I do like them. Because we can thank God for every person that he has put in our life. If you look back on your life, you will clearly see that some of the people that were the strongest ones that just irritated you and you didn't want to be around them, guess who changed? You did. I did. God knows what he's doing. So I want you to look at your list and ask yourself, how does manipulation play into this? How do I manipulate to get rid of these people or put them in my life? Or, you know, I've seen people, you go somewhere, I don't know, I'll just say, let's say we go to a concert of some famous person in the world, and we can push our way up to get to meet that person. But you know, in God's eyes, that person's no different than the homeless guy sitting on the corner. In fact, if we pushed our way to that homeless guy, it's probably more in God's realm. But we go still by the world. We still are listening to the world. And as we go through these lists, I pray that we can stop allowing the world to tell us what's good and what's evil, and just know that we know that God is good. Amen. All the time.
Amen.
Proverbs 19:5 says, "A false witness will not go unpunished, and whoever pours out lies will not go free." Ask yourself, I'm asking myself, when somebody does something that hurts me, or they speak against me, or they're telling me what I need to do and how I need to do it, that's their problem. But we don't do that. Sometimes we take it to heart and we try to change, but that shouldn't be either. The one that tells us how to change is the Lord. And if we've given power to people to come into our life and tell us how we don't do this right, and we need to do this, and you should have done this, and now it's time, and just stop listening to that. That's not the Lord. The Lord speaks very, very kindly about us. I'm going to take us there in a minute. But the people that are out there telling everyone else what they should do, how they should do it, what they can't do, why they can't do it, I want you to go to Proverbs 21. And I think it identifies it quite well. Every way of a man is right in his own eyes. I remember I always said to my kids, did you notice your kids are really good at coming back and telling you everything you did wrong? It's kind of their job, they think. But I always say to them, you know, everything I did for you, at the time I did it, right or wrong, I did it because I thought it was right. And I did it because I loved you. Maybe we should start to remember that all these people that we're judging, when they're doing things, they're doing it because they think they're doing it right. They think they're doing it their best. And the best way for us to watch them change is to take them to the Lord in prayer and ask the Lord to show you what's right and quit telling them what they do wrong. Because I think that adds to bearing false witness. Last week I confessed to you that the Lord really knocked me over the head with, Cindy, it's your sin that's bringing evil in the world. And because of evil in the world, that's why we have sickness, disease, and all these things going on. And when he told me it was my sin, myself, my turning away from him, that really changed me. God can do that to us. And then I said to him, show me where I need to change. That's called submission. That's called obedience. That's called trust. Because every man, in Proverbs, I'll go back there, every man, every way of a man is right in his own eyes. But the Lord weighs the heart. Are you right in your own eyes because you are so important to you? Or, many times, I've said this before, hurting people hurt people. And so a lot of times the ones that are pointing out all your faults and failures, it's because they're hurt. And they need somebody to come and put their arm around them. They need Jesus to show them how right they are in his eyes, not theirs. His. Maybe they've been taught since little on, you never do anything right. I ask you to do this and you can't do anything right. Isn't it amazing that when we were little children, one statement like that can live with us for 70 years? Isn't it time we grow up and let that go? 3 says, to do justice and judgment is more acceptable to the Lord than sacrifice. If I try to be just to people, and I watch my judgment, and allow God to do what he can do best, that's more acceptable to the Lord than sacrificing. Number 4 says, a high look and a proud heart and the plowing of the wicked are sin. Then I went down to 28. This is really important. If you don't want to change, this may want make you want to change. A false witness will perish. But a man who listens will speak forever. How many times in this church we've gone in that room because we know that of ourselves we're not all that great. But when we go in that room and we empty ourselves and we listen to God and we proclaim what he says, it's beautiful. It's unified. It's harmony. I got God bumps. It is perfect because God is perfect.
Amen.
When we speak of the love of the Lord, and I'll tell you, when you do this, you are not going to be pointing fingers at people and telling them what they need to do. Because what's going to happen is you're going to speak in love. You're going to encourage people. You're going to be saying kind things to them. You're going to be erasing those statements that they heard when they were little, like, you're not worth it, you can't do this, you never do anything right. God says you are right because I am right.
Amen.
And I'm in you, so therefore you are righteous.
Amen.
Amen. I want us to reflect on every time that we sin, it puts more evil in the world. Do you really want to be adding to the evil? We all say, don't we, how rotten and evil this world is right now. But nothing's new under the sun. Go back and read the scriptures. Many, many, many evil times, evil days. Bondage, famines, desperate lives. Don't think we have it hard. We are blessed. We have the Lord and we have a free country. Praise
Amen.
God.
What if we quit worrying about the world and we start saying how wonderful God is? You see, if evil is blocking God from coming back and straightening out this world, then I'm adding to it by questioning God. And I need to get down on my knees and change my ways. And I need to do it now. N-O-W. I need to own it. Remember when I flipped those words, the letters. N-O-W, make it O-W-N. I need to own it now. And then guess what? I've won. So when do we need to do this? We need to do this all the time. I need to change all my ways that are putting evil out there. I need to have a smile on my face. I need to stand up with the love of God leading me and guiding me. And I need to quit making excuses for myself. I said last week, we pray for Maxine many, many times during the day. We listen and to hurt people, we comfort them. And if we could have that amazing power to have her stand up and be healed right now, who wouldn't do that? We'd all be praying that right now. And that is our prayer. But we also have to trust God and go deeper. And we have to begin to change here. We've already given Maxine to the Lord. We're going to keep praying for her, but we have to know that we trust God. We're going to see miracles. We're going to see. We already are.
Amen.
You see, God has created all things, and therefore all things are good. So remember last week, those that weren't here, I'll just tell you a brief reminder of what you missed. If we took a tube of toothpaste and that toothpaste showed the things that we say, and we squirt that toothpaste out on a paper plate, and that's my words for the day. This morning I got up and I spoke like this to my husband. Boom, press it out. I got here and this is how I spoke to people in the church. Boom. I went out and I talked to people before the service, and this is what we talked about. Boom, there's more. And all of a sudden, you realize some of the things that you spewed out, you want to take back. How are you going to get it back in the toothpaste tube? Doesn't go, does it? That really encourages me to watch what I say. I love it when people start to say things that they know are not going to bring goodness into the world. And if I say to them, wait, well, I just want to say it. Don't say it. Well, I just have to say it. Don't say it. Your words create. It's all about you. If you have to just get that one insult or bad thing out, why? Why are you putting it out there? You can't take it back. It's out there forever. And it brings curses on you and others. What if we begin today, right now, to turn from each thing that we take for granted and begin to work with God in His direction to bring more good in the world than the evil that we've been bowing down to? Start, if you're married, start with your husband and wife. Now this might throw something at me. Charlie, you're a good catcher. If anything comes thrown at me, catch it, will you? How do we treat the person that gave us their life? Our anniversary for 50 years is going to be this Thursday. And when I look back and I think of what I could have done that I didn't do, I squeezed out stuff. I can't get it back in the tube. That's where love and forgiveness comes in. And in Corinthians, it says, love does not keep a record of wrongs. Right? Right? Is that what we do? Do you remember in 1973 when you... You see, once it's out there, we take that paper plate, we take that toothpaste, and we just keep smearing it. And we just keep smearing it to the one person that walked down that aisle and gave us their whole life forever and ever till death do us part. That brings me to my knees. We need to be grateful and thankful because we are blessed. I watched an episode of the Golden Girls last night, and what's her name? Blanche ran into her husband that had passed away. And she had this secret admirer, and she ran out of the room. She goes, "That's George, and George died." Sorry, George. George died years ago. And all the other Golden Girls were just amazed. And then George came back and he told her he faked his death because he just didn't want to be married to her. But now he's come back 7 years later and he wants to apologize and that he really needs her. And I'm sitting there watching that. And then all of a sudden it switched. She gives him a hug and she said, "Do you know how many nights I wish you were in my bed when I rolled over and you weren't there for me?" And all of a sudden it flips to her being in the bed and she rolls over and he's not there because it was a dream. We need to be grateful. We need to be thankful. And for those that have already had their spouse go to heaven, we need to pray for them. We need to encourage them as they keep walking on. And for those that choose not to have a spouse, we need to be thankful for that. Because God is good in every situation of our life. What if I ask God to help me see what He sees in others? This is what He sees. Would you please go to Ephesians 1? I really hope that you go through this often this week. We're going to start at verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. How often do you say to our God, bless you, Lord? Thank you, Lord. Thank you for blessing us with every spiritual blessing through Christ. Can you imagine if families start to praise God that way? Maybe at every meal. Before we eat and pray for our food, why don't we thank God for who He is and what He does and what He's done for me? He gave us Jesus. It doesn't get any better than that.
Amen.
For since just as He chose us, I want you to think about that. God chose you. All those people on your do not like list, God chose them. You know why you don't like them? Because you don't like them. But that doesn't mean God doesn't like them. It's because it's all about you. And they don't do what you want, and they don't act like they should. And so I'll just eliminate them from my life, when God may have them there to strengthen you and to change you. God chose us in Him before the foundation of the world. When I think that I'm that important to God, that I can't even wrap my head around that. And we're here right now in this time for this purpose, because we have a purpose. And we are to be holy and blameless before Him in love. That one underline, and ask yourself, am I holy? Am I blameless? Do I come before you in love? Do I take that love out to others? Or do I tell them how they hurt me and what they've done? It doesn't say we're allowed to do that anymore, so it might be a good idea to stop it now. He predestined us to adoption as sons to Himself through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of His will. We're not here for our pleasure. We are not here because if it doesn't go our way, then we're not going to do it. We're here for His good pleasure. That's how much He loves us. He loves watching us little kids. And He adopted us. Some people in here may have adopted children. Just think, when you've got that child, we've got adopted children in our family. They're no different than a biological child. We got just as excited when that child came. One of my adopted nephews I'm closer to than some of my biological nephews. God did everything for us according to His good pleasure. And yet sometimes we go, well, that doesn't please me. And it doesn't. I get that. But it's not about us. If we do what He put us here to do, then we're going to end up doing what He wants us to do. To the praise of the glory of His grace, which He graciously bestowed on us in Jesus, in the Beloved. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. You need to go to the Lord and ask Him to get those blinders off. Remember I said sometimes we look like this and all we see is what's in front of our face. And there's a whole big world out there, and you are a part of it for an amazing purpose. In him we have redemption through his blood and the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished on us in all wisdom and insight. If I have redemption through his blood, and I'm forgiven through his blood, of all my sins through his blood, according to the riches of his grace, I don't really care what somebody says about me.
Amen.
Because I can't shut them up. One thing you don't want to do is try to chase after those naysayers and explain yourself. Because it's never going to be good enough, and you're just spinning your tires. Stop it. Find out what God wants you to do and let them go. Pray for them, but let them go. 9 says, he made known the mystery of his will. That means I can't say I don't know what the will of God is. He made it known to us. It's a mystery, and he made it known according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself. You know how you find the will of God based on this word? You know how you find that mystery? You stay with him. You allow him to work your life, and when you feel joy and peace, you're in it. When you feel confused and sad and upset and angry and mad, you're out of it. Go back to him and say, I need you. Show me. He purposed in himself as a plan for the fullness of time. All time. Nothing's, from the very beginning to now, nothing's changed. His plan is still in work and it's in motion, and the mystery is working according to his will and his good pleasure, and we can join that. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Or we can stay out of it and keep complaining and belly aching and wanting what we want. Or we can join him and say, I'm in. I'm in. Lord, I offer my life to you. Everything I've been through, I give, take it for your glory. The reason he has this plan is to unite all things in Christ, which are in heaven and on earth. Praise God. In him also we have received an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his own will, that we who were the first to hope in Christ should live for the praise of his glory. My question is, are we living for the praise of his glory? Is that what you're putting out when you squeeze your toothpaste tube? Because if we're praising him and glorifying him in all things, we'll never want to take that and try to put it back in the tube. Let's press out more. In him you also, after hearing the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and after believing in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. Praise God. Mm-hmm. Who is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory? I'm going to ask you to take that home and read the rest of it slowly. Chew on it. Live in it. Ask God on every single verse to change you and to point out what you need to do. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength.
Thank you.
I can say kind words about my neighbor. Let's say that. I can say kind words about my neighbor. I can say kind words about the world. Did you know that? Do you know that you can say kind words about the world? It's not what we're hearing, but you can. I can say kind words about the life that God has blessed me with. Is that what you say? Is that what you're squirting out? Are you telling everyone how great you've got it? Or are you telling people that they should feel sorry for you because of what you're going through? I can be a reflection of Jesus by my love. Did you know that? I can reflect Jesus by my love. They will know we are Christians by our love. So today I commit to going to the Lord. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads and just listen. And if you want to do this, you choose to do it. And if you don't, just be very quiet, please. Lord, today I commit to go to you. I want to see everything from your lens, from your eyes, Lord. Dear Lord, please grant me the serenity and help me to accept the things I cannot change. Would you please help me to stop trying to change them? Then please give me the courage to change the things that I can in me. And please give me the wisdom to know the difference, to know what I'm changing is from you and not a lie of the enemy. 1 Chronicles 4:10, we're going to say the prayer of Jabez again. Jabez. O Lord, bless me indeed. Enlarge my territory. Keep your hand upon me. Protect me from all evil so that I may not cause pain. And God granted him what he requested. Please take your paper. We're going to say what we believe. Ready? I believe in God. You can read it with me. The Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. For anyone that wasn't here last week and heard Holy Catholic Church and wanted to throw up, it means universal. It's God's holy church. It's not a denomination. You see, it's just a matter of time until we are with the Lord. Looking back this week at old videos, Rich and I, Jim and Sylvia loaned us a machine so we could take our VCR tapes and put them onto DVDs. And we're having a ball looking at the old tapes when they come up. And I found my great aunts and uncles at a reunion, and when I figured out their age, they're like my age. They were old back then. And when I watch these, we watch them together, we're really growing closer, are we not? Because we're seeing how quickly life passes us by, and we're seeing all these people, and they're in heaven now. And it makes you realize, what am I really worried about? Why would it be to my advantage to hold on to anger and bitterness, hurts and grudges? What's it going to gain for us? When I look at them and watch them having fun, and I think, they're all in heaven now. I hope that they weren't angry with each other. I hope that they weren't bitter. I hope that they were appreciative of their spouse. I hope that they really lived life to the fullest. But I don't know. And their chance is gone. I still have time. I still have a chance. And I can change and make it better. What is that doing when I hold on to all that ugly stuff? What's that doing in our dark world? I'm allowing the light of God's love to be shut off in me. And right now, the Lord needs the light, does he not? No one person will ever, ever, ever be all that you need. If you're looking for a person, or you can't get over the fact that somebody hurt you, or if you're in a divorce situation and you can't forgive the ex-spouse or whatever it is, they're never going to be able to give you all you need. The only one that can give you all that you need is God, because he created you and he put you right where he put you. And he's just waiting for you to embrace him. Tommy called me on Thursday night and he said, I'm sorry to call you late, but you can call me anytime. But I just wrote a new song. And I got excited because we had gone to see Richard Perrin. For those that know Richard, he's in a care center. It's actually like a group home. And it breaks your heart when you get in there and he says, I just want to go home. I wish I could come to church. You see, everyone that's in church today, we really should stop and thank God that we're able to be here.
Amen.
Instead of maybe saying, oh, it's Sunday again, do I have to get up? And we should be going, God, thank you that I can go be with people that love you and get what you need me to have. Here, Tommy, while I'm going to, Rich and I are going to visit Richard, and it was so cute. Because I walked in and he's kind of looking at me, and the minute he saw Rich, he went, Rich, hi Rich, I love you guys. It was my husband that he recognized first. Praise God. I believe this song, what we're going to play here in a minute, is going to become one of Table of Grace's important ministry tools. What I see with this song is that we are going to go out, and we've asked George if next week when Tommy gets back, if we can go, I want to take church to some of these people.
Amen.
So when we get together, and we're blessed to get together on Sunday, what if occasionally we got in our cars and we went to see Richard? And we sang him this song. What if we went over and prayed with Maxie? Not two or four or six of us, but as many as we can fit in her little house. And let her know that we're praying for her. And sang her this song. Bob's going to put the words up on the board. And as you listen to the words, I want you to think of Richard and Maxine and Wally and Eleanor. Lori Lee, not Lori Lee, but look, what's the lady you guys go?
Lorelai.
Thank you. Everyone that hasn't been here in a while. Do you know, if you know the truth, they're probably wishing they could be here with us. I don't want to take this for granted, do you? I would go over and take everybody to Richard today, except I can't carry the keyboard with me and Tommy's leaving, so. He wants to go to church. He needs fellowship. We all should want to go to church, and we all do need fellowship. So what if we take this song out and we start singing it to those that are out? What if we started to bring church to them? Wouldn't that be cool? We can take communion and we can take church to them. You see, we can do this. When we close our eyes to this world, I want you to get this, and we all will. Nobody in here is going to die with all of us with them. Unless they die here in the church, but I pray they don't. But when you close your eyes in this world and you open them, you're by yourself looking at Jesus. And what do you want to hear him say? I pray that we hear him say, well done, good and faithful service. Give me a minute to turn the keyboard on. We're going to play this song for you. It's called Matter of Time.
This is not my words, they're God's. But I tell people I'm not a songwriter, but I am a good can holder.
Amen.
And he's dealt with me with this song for a couple of months with the melody part of it. And Thursday, he said, sit down and write. And it's all about him. But you know, if we look at it, it's just a matter of time. Either Jesus coming back or we're going to go be with him, one or the other.
You know, I'm feeling like we should all say the words first and then we'll sing it, so that these words, I really believe it's a ministry song. So Bob, kind of bear with us. We'll all recite them, okay? It's a matter of time before I see Jesus. A matter of time before I go home. It's a long road I know, but with him it's made easy. I'll see him, I know. It's just a matter of time. Like the prodigal son, I chose to wander. Like the prodigal one, Jesus welcomed me home. Now I'm in his love. No more will I wander. I'm on that straight, narrow road that leads to God's throne.
We'll read verse 2. Can you get to verse 2, Bob?
When I leave this world, there's no doubt where I'm going. When my eyes close in death, his sweet face I'll see. All I want to hear is welcome my child. It's a job that has been well done. This will all take place. It's just a matter of time.
All right, let's go back to the beginning and we're going to sing it. And I pray that this touches your heart the way it touched mine.
It's a matter of time.
Jesus, welcome me home.
Just a matter of time. And if we remember that it's just a matter of time, it'll make a difference in our life. Do you believe?
Yes.
So now it's time for communion. Let's get the elements.
Remember, we have a choice in what we speak. We can speak about people, or we can speak the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The name that brings power and healing and forgiveness. As for me and my house, we're going to choose the Lord, right?
Amen.
I just want to close out with 1 Corinthians 6. Going to the law before unbelievers. Dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to the law before the unrighteous and not before the saints? Do you not know that the saints will judge the world? If the world will be judged by you, are you unworthy to judge the smallest matters? Do you not know that we shall judge angels? How much more the things that pertain to life? If then you have judgments dealing with matters of this life, do you appoint as judges those who are least esteemed in the church? I think it's really important that before we vote for some of these judges, we pray and we ask God to lead the judicial system to be godly. Now's the time. I speak to your shame. Is it true that there is not even one wise man among you who shall be able to judge between his brothers? But brother goes to the law against brother and before unbelievers at that. Now, therefore, it is already an utter failure for you that you go to the law against one another. Why not rather be wronged? Why not rather be defrauded? But you yourselves do wrong and defraud and do this to your brothers. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor male prostitutes, nor homosexuals, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. Such were some of you, but you were washed, you were sanctified, and you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus, by the Spirit of our God. That's what our job is, to go out in this dark world and let all these people that don't know him get to know him, because when they do, they're going to be washed clean. They're not going to be judged. They're going to be brought in, and the Lord Jesus and his Spirit is going to touch them and transform them. If you think you're retired and you have nothing to do, I don't believe you.
Amen.
This is a huge call. We need to take the love of Jesus wherever we go. We need to speak the name of Jesus. Amen. Debbie on Thursday said this prayer kept coming in her head, and I love it, and I wrote it down. And I'll try to send it to you, Lori, so we can put it in the bulletin and in the email. It's called a prayer for protection. The light of God surrounds me. Just think of that. We're all surrounded by His light. Do you see it? The love of God enfolds me. Picture being just wrapped in the love of God. The power of God protects me. The presence of God watches over me. Now, here's the part I love. Wherever I am, God is. Amen.
Amen.
And then Debbie added, I am one with God. Amen. So what do you think would happen if we all go out and spread goodness, love, and peace? What do you think would happen? My question is, are you committed and are you ready? Then go get them, Tigers. All right.